Good afternoon, fellow finance classmates. So today, we're going to be talking about the cost of capital. So the cost of capital represents the firm's cost of financing and is the minimum rate of return that a project must earn to increase firm value. So obviously, as a firm, we're going to take on projects trying to earn money. So there's risk associated with this in that we have to make sure we're earning enough money from the project to make it worth our while, because we're going to have costs associated with the business endeavors during the project. So the cost of capital, like I said earlier, it represents the firm's cost of financing and is the minimum rate of return that a project must earn to increase firm value. So first, the cost of capital is pretty complex. There's a lot of, over here, these represent different components that go into calculating the cost of capital. So what we're going to do is start with some basic terminology first, and then I'll get into the formula that each of these requires in order to calculate the variable, and then we'll find the weighted average cost of capital. So to begin, we'll start with a little caveat that to capture all of the relevant financing costs, assuming some desired mix of financing, look at the overall cost of capital rather than just the cost of any single source of financing. So first we'll talk about some sources of long-term capital. These include long-term debt, stockholders' equity, preferred stock, common stock equity, common stock, and retained earnings. So now a couple more definitions. First we'll start with pre-tax cost of debt, which is the financing cost associated with new funds through long-term borrowing, typically funds raised through the sale of corporate bonds, and that's pre-tax as well, so not including the tax expense. Net proceeds would be the funds actually received by the firm from the sale of the security, where pre-tax we don't account for any of the costs, it's just the gross value that we earn, where the net proceeds take out the costs and the tax associated with selling the security. So these costs are known as flotation costs. It's the total cost of issuing and selling the security. And there's two components that go into flotation costs. There's underwriting costs, which are compensation to investment bankers for selling the security. And the second component that goes into flotation costs are administrative costs, which are issuer expenses such as legal, accounting, and printing. So underwriting and administrative are the two components of flotation costs. So first, we'll start, the first component for cost of capital we're gonna begin with is R sub D, which is before tax cost of debt. So in these examples, we're gonna be talking about Dutch's Corporation. So what I'm gonna do is talk a little, give some background about each component of cost of capital, and then we'll use the formula to find the percentage that goes along with our examples. So, okay. Which this is R sub D. Before tax cost of debt is represented by the variable R sub D. So what the before tax cost of debt is the rate of return the firm must pay on new borrowing. So there's three different ways we can calculate this. The first way is by using market quotations. So what you would do is observe the yield to maturity on the firm's existing bonds or bonds of similar risk issued by other companies. So basically, it's just a comparative basis where you're going to just use close to the market. The second way of calculating R sub D is by calculating cost. So you would find the before tax cost of debt by calculating the yield to maturity generated by bond cash flows. And the third way is by approximating cost using a formula. So that's what we're going to do. So the formula is a little bit lengthy, but here it goes. So R sub D is equal to dividend plus base value of all at once, or 1,000 in most cases, minus the net proceeds over the cost, which this quantity is over net proceeds plus base value divided by 2. So I'll leave that example up there for a second. I'm going to have to erase it to make room for the actual numbers. So we'll go back to the example. Again, we're talking about Dutch's Corporation in each of these calculations. So Dutch's Corporation, a major hardware manufacturer, is contemplating selling $10 million worth of 20-year 9% coupon bonds with a par value of 1,000. Because current market interest rates are greater than 9%, the firm must sell the bonds at $980. Flotation costs are 2% or $20. Net proceeds to the firm for each bond is therefore $960. So there was some terminology that we learned earlier, net proceeds for flotation costs. So we'll just plug in the numbers simply. So the dividend interest rates, 9% on a $1,000 bond, so it's going to be $90 for the dividend. Then we have the face value minus net proceeds. So we're selling it at $980, but the flotation costs are $20. So therefore, we would fill in $960. Overhead, which is the cost, which we know is $20. Then all we got to do is fill in net proceeds down here as well, which is $960. So I'll skip calculating all of these individually. And the end percentage that we come out with is 0.0938 or represented by a percentage, 9.388%. So this is again the before tax cost of debt, which is represented by R7E. So we'll go ahead and write this number up here to keep a running total, so that way at the end we can compare each of the totals, and these are also going to build on each other. So okay. So there is the before tax cost of debt. Okay. So we just got finished covering the before tax cost of debt, so naturally there's going to be an after tax cost of debt. So let's write that up here. After tax cost of debt, which is represented by R sub I. So this is pretty simple. Basically, after tax cost of debt is just, you take the before tax cost times one quantity, one minus the tax rate. So, a little bit more in-depth background about the after tax cost of debt. So the interest payments paid to bondholders are tax deductible for the firm. So the interest expense on debt reduces the firm's taxable income and therefore the firm's tax liability. So the after tax cost of debt, R sub I, can be found by multiplying the before tax cost, R sub B, which we found previously, by 1 minus the tax rate, T, as stated in the following equation. So here's the equation for after tax cost. So it's R sub I equals R sub D times 1 minus T. It's pretty straightforward. And like we said, these are going to build on each other, so that's why we write down 9.388%. So Dutch's Corporation has a 40% tax rate. So using the 9.388% we found earlier from the before tax cost of debt, we're just going to plug this into the equation. So R sub I equals to 9.388 times 1 minus the tax rate, which is 40%. So 9.388 6 comes out to be 5.63%. Which represents RSY and the after-tax cost of debt. So we'll go ahead and write that to keep a running total of it. After-tax cost of debt is 5.63%. So typically, the cost of long-term debt given or for a given firm is less than the cost of preferred or common stock, partly because of the tax deductibility of interest. So we'll look at, once we find the cost of preferred common stock, we'll look at the percentages to see how they compare to each other. So now we're going to move on to the cost of preferred stock. So notes here. Cost of preferred stock is represented as R sub E. So let me write that down real quick. Cost of, abbreviate preferred stock, which is R sub P. So what preferred stock is, so you can be a preferred stockholder or a common stockholder. We're talking about preferred stock here. So those stockholders, preferred stockholders, have the right to receive dividends before common stockholders. So they have seniority in that sense, or I guess they have the choice to receive their dividends before anybody else. So that's the perk whenever you buy preferred stock. So these dividends can be stated as either a cash amount or an annual percentage rate. So if it's an APR, it's just going to be, the percentage is going to be the percent of par value equal to the annual dividend. So as we learned earlier, in a prior example for before cost or before tax cost of debt, there is a 9% interest rate and a $1,000 par value, which gave us a dividend of 90. So in that case, 9% of the par value is a dividend. So let's get into the formula. Again, a pretty straightforward formula here. So R sub E, or the cost of preferred stock, is equal to D sub P over N sub P. So E sub P represents the dividend of preferred stock, and N sub P represents the net proceeds from the sale of preferred stock. So next, we'll go back to Dutchess and bring another example to find their cost of preferred stock. So Dutchess Corporation is contemplating the issuance of a 10% preferred stock that they expect to sell for $87 per share. The cost of issuing and selling the stock is expected to $5 per share. The dividend is $8.70, which is found by taking the 10% dividend rate times the price, which is 87. So the net proceeds are equal to $82, which is the price of 87 minus the $5 of the cost. So therefore, we're just going to plug these numbers in. So first, in the numerator, we have $8.70 as the dividend, and in the denominator, we have the net proceeds for $82. So, whenever you divide 8.7 by 82, you get 10.6%, and that's going to be our cost of preferred stock. So, we'll write that up over here in the corner. Okay, so we just talked about the cost of preferred stock. So now we're going to move on to the cost of common stock. Cost of common stock, which is represented by R sub S. So for common stock equity, there are, well, first let's talk about it, and I'll get into the different methods. So, cost of common stock, return required on a stock by investors. of CS financing. There's retained earnings, and then there's new issues of common stock. So, cost of common stock equity is the rate at which investors discount the expected dividends of the firm to determine its share value. So, like I said, there are two different methods for determining cost of common stock. So, first, we'll start with the Gordon model. The long name for it is the constant growth valuation model, or the Gordon model. So, what the Gordon model is, in the Gordon model, it assumes the value of a share of stock equals the present value of all future dividends, and then assuming to grow at a constant rate. So it's the present value of all future dividends expected to provide over an infinite time horizon. So go ahead and write this one. So constant growth valuation, aka the Gordon. So, we'll go ahead and write the formula down for it. So, R sub S, which is cost of common stock, is equal to D sub 1. It's about D, I'll write that. So, D, how much better? Everybody tells it D sub 1 over P sub O plus G. So, D sub 1 is the per share dividend expected at the end of year 1. P sub O is the value of the common stock. And G is the constant rate of growth in the dividends. So going back to our Dutchess Corporation examples. So Dutchess Corporation wishes to determine its cost of common stock equity, or R sub S. The market price, P sub O, so go ahead and fill this in as they're given to us. The market price, P sub O, of its common stock is $50 per share. So the price, $50. The firm expects to pay a dividend, D sub 1, of $4 at the end of the coming year, 2016. We got P sub 1 as $4. So next, to find G, we're going to talk about the past year's dividends. So the dividends paid on outstanding stock over the past 6 years, 2010 through 2015, were as follows. So in 2015, they paid a dividend of $3.80, 2014, $3.62, 2013, $3.47, 2012, $3.33, 2011, $3.12, and 2010, $2.97. So we can see that they increased year. So the annual rate at which the dividends have earned, or G, is about 5%. It's really 0.505, but we're just going to keep it at 5 to keep the numbers kind of simple. So then we'll fill in our equation with G as 0.05. So then calculate this real quick. 4 divided by 50 is 0.08 plus 0.05, which gives us a cost of common stock using the Gordon model of 0.13 or 13%. So we'll go ahead and write this. This might be a little bit hard to see, but if you can zoom in on it, it says R sub S, and then in parentheses the Gordon model. So we're going to have another R sub S whenever we use the second method of calculating cost of common stock. So we just finished covering the Gordon model. So let's move on to the second method, which is the capital asset pricing model, or CAPM. It's the acronym for that, naturally. So let me write that on the board. Capital asset pricing model, So, talk a little bit about CAPM. So CAPM describes the relationship between the required return, R sub S, and the non-diversifiable risk of the firm as measured by the beta coefficient, B. So right off the bat, we're bringing into play risk, which is represented by beta, which the Gordon model did not use. So we'll go ahead and get into it. So we've got, again, it's R sub S, because we're still doing the cost of common stock. So R sub S equals R sub F plus quantity beta B times quantity R sub N minus R sub F. So, again, kind of simple, pretty short equation. So we'll talk about what each of these variables represents. So obviously, R sub S, cost of common stock. R sub F is the risk-free rate of return. R sub N is the market return, and then beta is our risk coefficient. So go back to Dutchess yet again. Dutchess Corporation now wishes to calculate its cost of common stock equity, R sub S, by using the capital asset pricing model. The firm's investment advisors and its own analysts indicate that the risk-free rate, R sub F, equals 7%. The firm's beta, is 1.5, and the market return is 11%. And this is R sub F, which we have here, which is 0.7. So go ahead and find, calculate that. So for Dutchess, we got 0.07. Plus, and then, so we got 1.5 times 0.11 minus 0.07, which is 0.04, times 1.5, comes out to be 6%, or 0.06. So then, that gives us cost of common stock equity using the CAPM model of 0.07 plus 0.06, which we have before, of 0.13, or 13%. So we'll go ahead and write that down. Again, you can zoom in on this. This says R sub S finding, or using the capital asset pricing model. Right here is 13. So we compare that to the board, and they're the same number. So we'll talk about the different scenarios in which you, or the different significances in using the two different methods. So the capital asset pricing method technique differs from the constant growth valuation model, Gordon model, in that it directly considers the firm's risk as reflected by beta, B, which was 1.5 in our example. So it considers beta in determining the required return or cost of common stock equity. So the constant growth model does not look at risk. It uses the market price, P sub O, as a reflection of the expected risk return preference of investors in the marketplace. So one uses the required and one uses the expected. The constant growth valuation model and capital asset pricing model techniques for finding R sub S are theoretically equivalent, though in practice estimates from the two methods do not always agree. So while these two might not always be the same in our example, but again, these, that's why I write them separately, just because they might not always come out to be the same number. Another difference is that when the constant growth valuation model is used to find the cost of common stock equity, it can easily be adjusted for flotation costs to find the cost of new common stock. So the capital asset pricing model does not provide a simple adjustment. So, as we just mentioned, we said the constant growth valuation model can be easily adjusted to find, or can be easily adjusted for flotation costs to find the cost of new common stock. adjustment is that difficulty occurs because in its common form, the model does not include the market price of P sub O. So just looking back at this, there's no market price of the stock. It's just the rates rather than the price, whereas the Gordon model has the P sub O in its formula. So that's where the difficulty in the adjustments are being made. So now that we've finished up, cost of common stock using two different models, we're going to start covering the cost of retained earnings. So, I'm going to abbreviate that as well. RE is pretty accepted for retained earnings. So, the cost of retained earnings is represented by the variable R sub R. So let's get a little bit of background about the cost of retained earnings. So it turns out this is a very straightforward one. So the cost for retained earnings is the same as the cost of an equivalent fully subscribed issue of additional common stock, which is equal to the cost of common stock equity, or R sub S. So literally, R sub R is always going to be R sub S. So the equation is R sub R equals R sub S. That's all there is to it. So I'll get into a little bit more detail about retained earnings. So whereas we had R sub S, so let's just plug this in real quick. R sub S equals 13%. So R sub R is going to be 13%. We'll go ahead and write that over here. You can zoom in on that if you want. So talking about retained earnings is the preferred source of financing in business. So, and it's not just in the United States. Both in the U.S. and most other countries, firms rely more heavily on retained earnings than any other source of financing. So R sub R is used more than any of these other components of cost of capital. So an example of this is in a 2013 survey of Chinese firms, they found that 64% of the companies surveyed listed retained earnings as one of their primary sources of funds. So further, bank loans in this survey were a distant second choice, mentioned as a primary source of funds by just 44% of the companies. So that's a 20% difference between retained earnings and bank loans. So pretty straightforward again, R sub R is always going to be R sub S. And again, retained earnings in most countries around the world is the primary source of financing. So pretty straightforward there. We're going to start covering the cost of new issues of common stock. So in when we were talking about common stock equity with the Gordon and the CAPM models, we talked about how the Gordon model can easily be adjusted to find cost of new issues of common stock, which we're going to get into. So the cost of new issues of common stock is represented by the variable R sub N. So what R sub N is the cost of common stock net of underpricing associated flotation costs. So we talked about flotation costs. We'll get into what underpricing means. So new shares are underpriced if the stock is sold at a price below its current market price. So the market dictates a cost for the stock, and if it's selling below that price, then the stock is considered to be underpriced. So we'll get the formula. R sub N. So R sub N is equal to D sub 1 over N sub N plus G. So this might look familiar. The only difference is we have the net proceeds instead of just the price. So this is the Gordon model formula from before, as you may have recognized. So, going back to Dutchess yet again. Well, actually, first let's talk about farming a little bit. So the net proceeds from sale of new common stock and to then will be less than the current market price of PSBO. Obviously, PSBO minus the cost gives you the net, or the gives you the net proceeds, so it's always going to be less. Therefore, the cost of new issues, R sub n, will always be greater than the cost of existing issues, R sub s, which is equal to the cost of retained earnings, R sub r. So just some, we're just kind of backtracking and talking about stuff we've already seen, but just making connections. So the cost of new common stock is normally greater than any other long-term financing cost. So we can expect R sub n to be greater than any of these previous numbers. So get back to Dutchess finally. Dutchess Corporation common stock is currently selling at $50 per share. So to determine its cost of new common stock, R sub n, Dutchess Corporation has estimated that on average, new shares can be sold for $47. So we would plug that in normally, but now we're gonna, we have to find a net. So there's a $3 per share underpricing between. So it was currently selling for 50, but then we said it was on average, it's being sold for $47, and that's because of the $3 per share underpricing, which is due to the competitive nature of the market. And there's another cost associated with new issues is or are the flotation costs, which we've learned about. So the flotation costs in this example are $2.50 per share. So it gives the total underpricing and flotation costs of $5.50, $3 underpricing, and $2.50 flotation costs. So $5.50. So what we're gonna do is take 50 for the net. We have our 50, sorry, not 50 for the price minus the cost of 5.5, which gives us net proceeds of 44.5 for our cost of new common stock equation. And so they don't restate it in this example, but as we learned before, going back to the Gordon model, the dividend at the year, or the end of year one for this stock was $4. And then we found G to be 5%. So now, whereas 4 was being divided by 50, it's being divided by a smaller number, so therefore it's going to be greater. So 4 divided by 44, or 44.5, is going to be 0.09 plus 0.05, which comes up to be 0.14, or 14%. So R sub n, the cost of new issues, CS, is 14%. So just going back to what we said just a couple minutes ago, typically we can expect R sub n to be greater than any of the previous long-term financing methods. And it is 14 is greater than 13, 10.6, 5.63, 9.388. So that stays true with what we just covered. So finally, we're gonna get down to the weighted average cost of capital. So we've been building on our knowledge of cost of capital with these different methods and different ways of financing. So now we're gonna get down to the big one. So the weighted average cost of capital. Weighted average cost of capital. So you might be thinking, none of these talk about the cost of capital. This one is finally the weighted average of the cost of capital. So this is the big one. And this is abbreviated by WACC, WACC. So let's get into it. So what the, and then it's also represented by R sub n. So what the weighted average cost of capital is, it reflects the expected average future cost of capital over the long run. is found by weighting the cost of each specific type of capital by the proportion in the firm's capital structure. So we're to break it down. With apart from the before tax cost of debt, this might be the longest equation, so it has some new variables, so I'll break this down. I'll write it down quickly though. W sub I, so R sub A equals quantity of W sub I times R sub I. Okay? Then we're going to be adding that to W sub P times R sub P. And then W sub S times R sub R. Or R sub N. So you might be thinking, why did you write that R sub R or R sub N? Which one is it? Because those are obviously different percentages. So I'll get to that in a minute. Well, different situations dictate which ones you use. So it just depends on the firm. So, okay, let's first talk about W sub I, W sub P, W sub S. So going back to the weighted average cost of capital, we said that it's found by weighting the cost of each specific type of capital by proportion in the firm's capital structure. These are representative of the proportions of the type of capital in our structure. So W sub I is the proportion of long-term debt in our capital structure. So long-term debt, this one is the proportion of preferred stock in our capital structure. Long-term debt, preferred stock, and W sub S is the proportion of common stock equity in our capital structure. So let's go back to Dutchess for this one. Actually, first, let's talk about some important points to note about WACC. So, first, so there's three important things we're going to go over right now. The first one being, for computational convenience, it is best to convert the weights into decimal form and leave the individual costs in percentage terms. So convert these to decimals, the W's, and then leave these in the percentage form, which is why I wrote them down in this manner. The second important point is that the weights must be non-negative, so none of these can be negative 0.0 whatever. So not only can they be non-negative, they have to add up to 1.0. So this has to account for all of our financing in our capital structure. So the third important point is we're talking about way back to cost of capital is the firm's common stock equity weight, W sub S, is multiplied by either the cost of retained earnings, R sub R, or the cost of new common stock, R sub N. Which cost is used depends on whether the firm's common stock equity will be financed using retained earnings or new common stock. So it just really is dependent on the firm's personal preference. So obviously in earlier examples, we already found all three of these. So let's go ahead and plug in. So R sub I was 5.63. And remember, we need to keep these in percentages and not decimals, just for computational purposes. So 5.63 plus the cost per stock, R sub P, which is 10.6. R sub R or R sub N. So R sub R is 13, R sub N being 14. So in this, Dutchess uses cost of retained earnings when talking about their weighted average cost of capital. So we're going to plug in the 13% here. So next, the company uses the following weights in calculating its weighted average cost of capital. So the long-term debt, or W sub I, is 40%. So again, going back, we convert these to decimals for computation's sake. 40%, 0.40, preferred stock is 10%, 0.10, and common stock equity is 0.50. So 50% comes from common stock equity, 10% comes from preferred stock, and 40% comes from long-term debt. So let's go ahead and do these numbers. So 0.4 times 5.63 is 2.2%. 10% times 10.6 is 1.1, and then 0.5 times 13 is going to be 6.5. So the total of this comes out to be 9.8% is the weighted average cost of capital. So we'll go ahead and write that down here. 9.8%. So next, so we're talking about the weighted average cost of capital. The last thing to wrap this all up, we're going to talk about the weighting schemes. So basically, there are two different types of weights. There's book value weights and market value weights. So book value weights are weights that use accounting values to measure the proportion of each type of capital in the firm's financial structure. And then we have market value weights, which is just the opposite. So we use accounting values for book value. Market value weights are weights that use market values instead of accounting values to measure the proportion of each type of capital in the firm's financial structure. So then we're going to talk about historical versus target. So historical weights are either book or market value weights based on actual capital structure proportions, based on history, things that actually occurred. Target weights are either book or market value weights based on desired capital structure proportions. They're a goal. They haven't occurred yet. They're what we want to occur, what we're wishing to occur. So desired capital structure proportions. So from a theoretical point of view, the preferred weighting scheme for a firm is target market value proportions. So again, that's going to be they're going to be using market value whenever they're weighting it, and these are going to be based on desired capital structure proportions. So again, just getting back, I know this was lengthy, but hopefully breaking it down into each component and showing the equations and the different variables and talking about the background of each different component, hopefully you're able to break it down more simply instead of just hearing cost of capital and saying, oh my gosh, that's huge. So breaking these down individually show the different significances and how they're all relevant into the cost of capital. So again, once more, this was a presentation on the cost of capital, and we'll go over what that means one more time. So the cost of capital represents the firm's cost of financing and is the minimum rate of return that a project must earn to increase from earned value. So